Continue discussing the spin half integer spin fields, and we'll see more details of the. We'll start with reviewing the solutions to the Dirac equation in terms of fields, some properties of the solutions, and then depending on the time, we'll start discussing what happens at the quantum level. Okay? So, just remember last time we arrived to the Dirac equation from the Lagrangian. So, a field that transforms as a spinor. The Lagrangian we wrote last time should satisfy this equation. These equations, we saw that they were leading to Klein-Gordon-like equations for the components of the four components of this spinor psi of x. But on top of those, there are more stringent equations, which are this Dirac equation, which correspond to constraints, because are only first order in time. And they effectively reduce the four complex components of the spinor, which would otherwise propagate eight different plane waves. They will reduce by half, because these are four equations, and you will see that indeed what propagates are just four different type of waves. Okay, so now we can just start writing the equation. Let me write it here, the solution. Psi of x. Since psi of x needs to satisfy Klein-Gordon equation, I can write psi of x, the solution, as a superposition of plane waves, exactly like we did for a scalar field. Psi is complex, so we'll have like for complex scalar field, we'll have two different coefficients in front of the positive and negative frequency modes. So let me use the same normalization. I'm going to write this as a superposition B3P over 2 pi Q, 1 over 2 omega P. So far, no surprise. Right. Then, here, I will need to write let me write here the plane waves e to the minus I px plus e to the I px. And for the complex scalar field, if you remember, we just were putting here some arbitrary coefficient a and b, or a and b dagger, depending on what I call them, of p. So for each momentum p, we're putting some independent coefficient. Now, here we have to put four spinors, because psi has a four spinor index, r, right? So here we need the four, in general we will need the four coefficients, one for each component. Let me call these coefficients here c and d dagger. These are the analogous of a and b. Just let me call them for spinor, let me call them differently. So if the Klein-Gordon equation was all we had, I mean this equation was the only equation of the system, then I would have here, effectively, this C will depend on momentum P, one for each Fourier mode, and then there will be an index R, one for each components of the spinor. And you see now that we'll have a 4 plus 4, 8 different type of waves. But this is not correct because we still have to impose this constraint that will reduce by a factor of 2 the number of independent coefficients. So this means that there will be only 2 of these and 2 of those. Still will be 4 spinors. Say?
The board is a bit darker now.
Dark for everybody? Yes.
I think so.
Okay.
So,
yes.
Let me see if I can turn on. Better?
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, good. So in general, we have written four independent components here, four independent components here, eight, but we have to impose these constraints, which eventually basically make survive only two components here and two components there. There will still be four spin-offs, but there will be out of the four different four spin-offs you can write, like 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 0, 1. Out of these four, there are only two independent ones that also satisfy this equation here. So, conventionally, I will write the four spin-offs independently, a basis of four spin-offs that satisfy also this equation. I write it here as UP, and this is, I call it VP. And there will be two, so these are four spin-offs, so we'll have index R here, and index R here. And there will be two of them. So let me put another index S here, and index S here. And S just go from 1 to 2. So I have two four spin-offs of type U and two four spin-offs of type V. In total, these four spin-offs are the four solutions of this equation, are a basis of solution for this equation here. And then I just, these bases I will normalize in some way, and then I leave this coefficient C and D free. And these coefficients are only two of type U and two of type V. So this I parameterize the most general solutions in this way. And in an analogous way, I can write the emission conjugate, psi bar, and the integral into P over 2 pi Q, 1 over 2 omega P, sum over S. Now I have to take the complex conjugate, so this I write as D, P, S, D, DAG, P, R, S, E to the minus I Px plus C, I was calling them tilde, but okay, just to be consistent, let me call them all tildes. This is the normalization which is automatically Lorentz covariant. C, P, S, dark, U, P, S, tag R into the IPX. So, if I take this as a classical equation of motion, this C and D are just coefficients. This U and V are just four spin-offs, which will satisfy some constraint, and then the rest is just Fourier modes. When we'll upgrade the fields to operators, and when we will quantize the theory, these coefficients C and D, and the dagger and C dagger, they will be operators. So those will be operators acting on the Hilbert space, while the rest, U, spin-offs will still be just four spin-offs, okay? Numbers, and similar for different ways. Okay. So, of course, here I implicitly assumed that P naught is equal to omega p equal to root of p squared plus m squared, because this ensures that this plane wave satisfies Klein-Gordon equation, exactly like in the scalar case. And before going to discuss now what these u and v's are, let me just briefly mention dimensions. You remember we argued from the Lagrangian that the dimensions in energy of the field psi must be 3 over 2 versus a scalar field dimension which was equal to 1. So if we want to keep the dimensionality of this C and D coefficients, then they will become operators, the same as the analogous A and B's of the scalar. And we want to do this so that when we compute the commutators, and then the commutators, they will be normalized with the same factor 2 pi cube, 2 omega, delta 3, with the same dimensions. Then, this is the fermionic field as 1 half a dimensionality, which is 1 half larger than the scalar field. We need to require that these spinors U and V have dimension of 1 half. The dimensionality of U and V in energy, this is a commutator. So the dimensionality in energy of U, and of V is 1 half. Okay. So that the coefficient C and D have the same dimensionality of the scalar field, which if you go and check, the dimensionality is minus 1 in energy. Okay. This is just a convention. Okay. So now all we have to do is just to impose the constraint from the Dirac equation on the spinors U and V and see what they imply, so what are the form of U and V. I guess this you might have already seen in the RQM course, right, when you already discussed the solutions of Dirac equation. In fact, they are the same. So if you just impose id slash minus n, for example, on psi, the derivative d mu on the first term pulls down a minus I p mu. So this will imply that I times gamma mu times d mu, which acts on here as minus I p mu, minus n, act on U must be zero, and the same, a similar equation for V, because of course I can switch on and off one by one this C and D coefficients. So, and for any choice of C and D, I want psi to be a solution of this equation. So let me turn on only C with a certain p and a certain s. All the other coefficients are zero. And this means that when I apply this operator to this particular psi, it must vanish. So in particular, that when I apply this operator here to u, it must vanish. So, and this, so minus I p mu plus 1, gamma mu p mu, I can also write short-end rotation as a p slash minus n applied to u p s is equal to 0. So you see, this is a full matrix, p slash, acting on spinor space, and the proportional identity matrix in spinor space. This is a full matrix acting on four spinor equal to 0. It will give some constraint about the components of this UPS spin. I can similarly derive the equation valid for V. All it changes is that when I take a derivative with P, I have an extra minus sign, which will produce an extra minus sign on the first term. So we'll get minus P slash minus N on V, which is equivalent to P slash plus N on V PS equal to 0. So these are the equation defining U and V up to an overall constant. You can take the Hermitian conjugate of this. So this will become an equation of U dagger, P slash dagger, same, blah, 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 which look like this. It can be written also as a U bar PS, just take the dagger. So you get the P slash minus M now acting from the right on U bar, that's equal to 0, and analogously here you get the equation which is V bar PS, P slash plus M equal to 0. So these are equivalent equations for the U dagger and V dagger. And you can check that if you compute V bar P S saturated with U with the same P but different any other R, this object is always zero. So if you want, the U's and the V bars are orthogonal. To check this, you can just take what you want to compute, V bar U, and insert the identity. So the identity, I can write it as one half plus one half, right? I can multiply and divide by M. And I can add and subtract the slash. And I notice that P slash plus N on the left of V give me 0. And P slash minus N or minus P slash minus M on U is 0. So this must be 0. Okay? All right, then I can now multiply by gamma naught this equation, or this one. I will start multiplying by gamma naught this, and write it explicitly. And with the very simple algebra, you can verify that this equation corresponds to the spatial P gamma naught gamma spatial plus gamma naught n applied to U P R is equal to omega P U P R. So this is exactly this equation written in components, right? You have P naught gamma naught plus P vector gamma vector. P naught is equal to omega P multiplied by gamma naught. You bring the omega P parts on the other side, and you rewrite this equation in this way. You can perform the same exercise for the second line, except there is a minus sign here. You can actually revert the minus sign and put the minus sign in P, and choose, instead of choosing the equation for Vp, you choose the equation for V minus P. If you do this, you arrive to this equation. P vector, gamma naught, gamma plus gamma naught n, the same combination, applying to V minus P, 3 vector, r, equal to minus omega P, V minus P, r. Okay. So now look at here. This is a matrix, 4x4 matrix, and is Hermitian. In fact, is in Fourier modes is exactly the same operator that appears in the Hamiltonian. Grad, remember, grad times gamma vector plus m gamma naught. So this is a Fourier transform of the Hamiltonian operator, and is Hermitian. Can check. And these equations are basically just the eigenvalue, eigenvector equation for the Hamiltonian. So you see that UPR represent an eigenvector of the Hamiltonian with eigenvalue omega p, and V minus p is an eigenvector of the same Hamiltonian with eigenvalue minus omega p. Since the Hamiltonian is Hermitian, if you have two eigenvectors associated to different eigenvalues, they must be orthogonal. So you get that U dagger P R V minus P S is 0. And besides, U of P and V of minus P represent a full basis for this Hamiltonian. Because this Hamiltonian is 4x4, there will be 4 eigenvectors, so you have 2 with the positive eigenvalues and 2 with negative eigenvalues. So UP and V minus P with the index R will go from 1 to 2 represent the 4 the full basis of the Hamiltonian with a fixed 3 momentum P of 4 spinors. So you can always choose an orthonormal basis. So U and V are orthogonal, and you can choose the inside the U's and the V's also a orthogonal basis. So in particular, you can choose the normalizations in this way. Now, here you can see. So you can choose U dagger A, scalar product with the U UP, UP S, equal to something that is proportional to the identity, delta S, is the orthogonal basis. But remember, we chose the normalization of U's such a way that they are dimension 1/2, so the product cannot be proportional to 1, must be proportional to something that has the same energy, has the same dimension as energy. So a conventional choice here is 2 omega p. Of course, we could have chosen any other normalization with the dimension of energy. The clever choice here is 2 omega p, because this object here indeed transforms, you will see, as the zero component of a 4 vector. And this is also the case for omega p, for the transform of the node. Similar for v dagger minus p, v minus p r and s, you can choose orthonormal basis, delta rs, and here also can normalize with the same factor 2 omega p. So this is a complete 4x4 basis orthonormalized, and u and v is also. You can consider, like we did here, vectors with the same p, and but in terms of v bar. So you can also consider now u bar p r, u p s, and v bar p r, and v p s. This can also be chosen orthogonal. The difference between this and this, you see, is just a gamma naught in between. Okay? Now, these guys here, this product here, are Lorentz invariant. It's like psi bar psi, remember, they do something like scalar. So here you can choose a normalization, which is proportional to something that is invariant, the mass. M. And here also delta f 2m. The only difference in this case is that now these products are not positive definite, because here you put a basis which was orthonormal, right? Because they come from u and u dagger, vv dagger come from an Hermitian Hamiltonian. But now you inserted here gamma naught, and gamma naught has positive and negative eigenvalues. So which means that at least two of these products must have a minus sign. So conventionally, they're chosen here. Okay, so these are just the normalization, orthonormalization of the basis of U as in this. And then, to completely fix, you have to impose the equations that I just erased, which was p slash minus m on u and p slash minus m plus m on v equal to 0. Those equations, of course, if you want an explicit solution, you have to commit on a particular basis for the gamma matrices. So depending on which basis of gamma matrices, which representation of the gamma matrices you choose, Pauli, Dirac, or Weyl, or so on, you will get a different explicit representation for the four spinors. So now I have a question. Did you see during the RQM course the explicit representation for the U and the V spinors? Maybe called in a different way. Silence. Either you can either answer with a yes or with a no.
Yes, we have seen the expression.
Okay. In which basis? In which with gamma representation of the gamma matrices? You remember?
I guess it was in the fundamental representation.
I meant which representation of the gamma matrices? Pauli Dirac, right? Only that one, or also maybe only that one?
I think we did one or two.
Weyl?
Yeah.
Okay. This is probably. I mean, it's just algebra. I will write it in the notes, so in case you didn't see it in RQM, you can find it in the notes if you need it, but they're not so important. So maybe I will not go into the details of deriving all of them. Important thing is you see them once, then, and you know where to find them if you need them. Okay, so any question about this discussion? Maybe I forgot. Let me just also give you one extra identity which will become handy later on. From here, this orthogonality condition, you can see that there is an analogous orthogonality condition at the level also of plane waves. So this also implies, if you want, that if you take the integral d3x, of a plane wave associated to U and a plane wave associated to V, they are orthogonal. What I mean is, you can take U, P, R, let's say I take the plane wave from here, U, P, to multiply e to the I, P vector, X vector, only the space part at fixed time, e to the I, P, X. So if you want, this is a one solution of the Dirac equation, one specific solution of the Dirac equation, a plane wave with the full spin of UP. And then I take basically the scalar product in function space with another plane wave of type V. This is V. Now I take the plane waves, it's always e to the ipx, so I choose the b minus p s, which has again e to the ipx as a plane wave. You see the appearance of this minus p here is just because we chose to call vp this guy here. When we did the very first time the solution of the scalar field equation of motion, remember that here we performed the p minus p change of variable just to make appear this covariant. And now we are not doing it, and we're just calling v of p this. This is why now there appears also always this minus p when you want to associate it with the right plane wave. Anyway, so if you perform now this integral, you see that, let me take a different plane wave, q. So you have a different momentum q and different spinor. If you perform the integral in d3x, it just gives you a delta function. There is a conjugate momentum, a complex conjugation here. So the delta is p minus q. So this is equal to, I hope you see, there is a 2 pi cube delta 3 of p minus q vector from the integration over x. And then you have the product u dagger p R V S minus P, because P and Q are the same. And thanks to this equation here, this is zero. So basically this orthogonality condition, you cannot see?
Yeah, the microphone is blocking.
Thanks. Let me see if I can move for a bit. No, I cannot move there. Okay, I rewrite it upstairs.
Thanks.
So it was 2 pi cube delta 3 of p minus q. This comes from the derivation of x. And then we have u dagger, u rp dagger, product with the V, S, minus P, because P and Q are the same thanks to the delta function. So V minus P, S. So U dagger V, like here, is zero. So this orthogonality condition actually allows the orthogonality of the full plane wave. So a full solution of the Dirac equation. So this identity basically we will use later when we will encounter products of fields. Another identity instead is the one coming from this normalization here. You can see that the U and the Vs represent also a full basis of four spinors with the same P. But of course this basis has a metric which is not positive definite, but you can use them to define a completeness relation. So you can write a let me write somewhere else otherwise. Here you can write a completeness relation in this way. You can write the identity is equal to U R E. This is the identity if you want at a fixed momentum P. U R P U bar R P over 2m minus v p r v bar p r over 2m sum over r 1 and 2. So this is if you want, okay, so now be careful, this is a matrix in spinor space, it's a 4x4 matrix which is AB. A and B are spinor indices. A is the index of this spinor, and B is the index of this spinor. I'm not contracting the spinorial index here. I'm just contracting instead the index that label one of these two spinors here. So this is a matrix in spinor space. This is a matrix. So this is the analogous of when you write a completeness relation by taking Brian Kate in this way, so we represent matrices. So this is the same in spinor space here. And indeed you can check that this represents identity. So if for example you take this operator and apply to UP with an index S, then V bar U is zero, from here. So this term is zero, while this term U bar U return here. U bar U return 2m delta. 2m and 2m simplifies. It gives you delta S, which fixes this U to S, and returns U to S. And similarly for B, this term is zero because U bar B is zero for a similar argument of this, just to give a complex conjugate. While if you apply this, you get identity, so you get B bar B, which is equal to minus 2m delta. 2m and 2m simplifies, the minus simplifies with this minus here, and you return B. So this is indeed is the identity operator, is the completeness relation for those at the fixed three momentum. This is a full basis of four spinors for that particular mode. And each of these two terms here actually represent a projector in spinor space, simply because this guy here is only non-zero when it applies to U. When you apply to V, give you zero. While this one only returns non-zero when you apply to V, and return zero when you apply to U. So this projects into the V spinor space, and this projects into the U spinor space, and they can be represented in a different way. This guy here can be represented simply by this vanishes when applied to V, so it can represent the P slash plus M over 2M. And this other guy here, I can represent it as AP slash minus n over 2n. I'm going to stick the other way around. In fact, written this way, it was exactly the same object we wrote here. This was the identity reconstruction. And indeed, p slash minus n, when applies to u, give you 0. Sorry, I was right before. P slash plus n, when applied to u, give you u, because p slash applied to u is equal to n times u, so they give you 2m over 2m1. When you apply to v, they give you 0. P slash minus n applied to u, give you 0. Apply to B, it gives you minus 2m over 2m, which is minus 1, with the x minus, it gives you 1. So these are also projectors on the U and B spinors. Any questions? All right, so this basically exhausts the descriptions of the Dirac equation and the solution. And also the properties of various parts of the solution. So now in principle we are fully ready to start discussing what happens when we try to quantize this theory. So this is the last chance to ask a question on this part, because then I will go into erase the whole blackboard to discuss the quantization. All right. Okay, so quantization. So all we have to do is the usual recipe that we already used for the scalar field. Just now take our field as an operator. And in principle, we should just apply commutation rules, right? Then from there, read the commutation rules of the C and V operators, the coefficients of the Fourier mode inside the field. And then see what happens from the commutation rules, recompute the Hamiltonian, and compute the spectrum. In principle, we should do that. If you try to do that, you'll get a problem. So I'm not going to waste all my time in that direction. I will shortcut that procedure just a little bit. So I will just assume that my field psi is an operator, which means that the coefficients C and D are now operator on a Hilbert space. but I will not impose yet any commutation rules on psi, thus on C and Ds. I will go directly to the computation of the Hamiltonian, assuming nothing about the way the operators commute or not commute. Okay? So we'll start from the Hamiltonian. And if you remember, last time we derived the expression of the Hamiltonian in terms of fields. In particular, we're going to use the expression of the Hamiltonian written in terms of solutions of the equation of motion, because after all, we are going to substitute the Hamiltonian in the solution of the equation of motion to compute the energy. So, I'm going to take this form. Well, form if you want, just I, psi dagger, psi dot. So what I have to do is just substitute here the expression for the solutions that we wrote before. So this is equal to I. I'm going to do it step by step, because just to show you that there is no trick. Integral in 3x, then I have to substitute psi dagger, so we wrote it before. Let me write it as the integral in v3p over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega p, sum over, I don't remember how you call it, r. Not going to write the spin or indices again explicitly, they are contracted between here and here, so keep it in mind. So the sum over r. Then I, for psi dagger here, I think I have d tilde p r, and then d dagger p r e to the minus I p x plus c tilde p r dagger u dagger p r e to the minus I p x, and this is my psi dagger, and then I multiply by psi dot. So psi dot is the integral in v3q over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega q, sum over s, so if I derive with respect to time, from the first terms I drop, as usual, a minus I omega q, so this omega q goes away, and there is an I that I win. And then I'm left with the c tilde q s u q s e to the minus I q x minus, when I take the time derivative, d tilde q s v q s e to the I q x. Right? Very good. In principle, I have four terms, right? Two times two. The integral. Yes.
The first parenthesis and the second exponential is plus.
Yes. Thank you. So I have to perform the integral in d3x. So the integral in d3x will produce some delta function in p minus q or p plus q. So in particular, let's start considering this term here. This times this. So if I take integral in d3x, from here I will get a delta 3 of p plus q, because they have the same sign. This will fix p to be minus q, But then at the level of spinors, I have V dagger U and P is minus Q. So I exactly have the V dagger minus P UP, or V dagger Q minus P, which were orthogonal, if you remember. So this will give me zero contribution. Same when I perform this product here. P and Q have opposite sign. So U dagger P, B minus P is zero. So the only terms that can give me a non-zero contribution are the first times the last, or the second times the first here. So let me write what I get. So first of all, I can simplify this I with this I. But the integral in V3x of the first product, the second product, will return a 2 pi cube. So this integral now will give me a 2 pi cube 2 omega p delta 3 of p minus q. Sorry, what did I mean? Just get too much used. The integral in V3x just give me 2 pi cube delta 3 of p minus q. Right? Because it's the integral of the spatial part of this and the spatial part of that. The time part at this point simplifies, because when p is equal to q, omega p is equal to omega q, they have opposite sign, and also the time part of the exponent disappears. Thanks to this delta, I can perform one of these two integrals for free. So I choose to remove the second one. So 2 pi cube and delta 3 can be simplified to the integral in V3q and 2 pi cube, so that I get all the q's are equal to this. So I'm left with an integral in V3p over 2 pi cube, 1 over 2 omega q, omega p, sorry. There is an extra factor of 1 half from there. All right, then I have sum over R and S. And now I get the two products. So for example, I take this product first. So I get C dagger C. Remember to keep always the ordering of the operator as they appear, because we're not allowed to use any commutation rule at the moment. So I'm going to write C R P dagger times C P S, and this multiplies the four spinors U dagger P R times U P S. Okay. And then there is another factor with a minus sign. There is a minus D tilde P R C, no, sorry, D. D P S tilde. I forgot some dagger. Yeah, this was supposed to be a dagger, so you can check. So this one should be dagger. Now the four spinners. Here I have a V dagger P R. There I have a VPS. And this is basically it. Okay. Oh, now I have the this nice product. You remember UWU, we decide to normalize the four spinors so that this product is just 2 omega t times delta s, and this is 2 omega p delta s. So which means that the sum of R and S must be the same. So I just sum over R and put S equal to R. And the 2 omega, I can pull it out. And this basically becomes omega. So this is the usual combination. I have omega p, now start resembling more and more like the usual Hamiltonian, right, in terms of creation invasion operators that we also observed for the scalar case. Remember, there was this Lorentz invariant prefab measure, the energy, and then there were the number operators. And here we almost get what we wanted, right? So let me write it now in more compact form here. Integral dd 3t over 2 pi q 1 over 2 omega p sum over r from 1 to 2 c t r dagger c t r minus d p r di dagger P R. So questions so far? All right, so we arrived at the form which is very familiar. Almost. So at this point, we have to choose what to do with the commutation rules. We are not allowed to exchange. So let me, for the moment, assume that we indeed impose the very same commutation rule that we used to impose for the scalar field, also for the spin 1 half field. Those commutation rules were basically telling me that allow me basically to rewrite this term here, dd dagger, in terms of d dagger d. And if I do that, this would be also equal to d dagger pr d pr minus the commutator between d tilde pr d pr dagger. Right, if you substitute the commutator, you get minus dd dagger simplified, sorry, minus dd dagger with reproduce this, plus the dagger d, which simplifies this. So these two terms are completely equivalent. But now, the usual commutation rules will tell you that this commutator between d and d dagger is just a number, some 2 pi, 2 omega, delta of 0, maybe infinite, but just constant. And you'll be left with this expression for the Hamiltonian, which now poses a problem, because these operators, d dagger c and d dagger d, will be positive definite by themselves, but the Hamiltonian will not, because of this sign minus. Which means that the more particle type c you produce, the larger the energy, but the more particle of type d you produce, the lower the energy. So the energy will go from minus infinity to plus infinity, will be unbounded from below, and the theory will be ill-defined. So we have a problem. This problem is if it has find its origin on the fact that our original fields are transformed non-trivially under a group which is non-compact. So the products that enter of the components don't have a positive definite metric. And this will lead basically to something that is not positive definite. So this is, you can explore the same problem if you, as an exercise, you try to quantize just scalar fields, but with a symmetry group, which is instead of SON, is like SON, N, like the Lorentz group, which is non-compact. Then you'll find that in your Hamiltonian, you'll get both signs appearing, which means that the Hamiltonian is not bounded from there. So does it mean that spin 1/2 fields cannot exist in nature because they are ill-defined? Of course not. But so it means that something went wrong when we imposed somewhere, in particular when we imposed our commutation rules. So for the moment, let me explore a different possibility. Let me explore the possibility that the commutation rules of these operators C and D are not the one of the scalar field. I'm going to choose different one to make things work. And then we'll come back to the implication later. Okay? So let me then impose the following commutation rules, or better, anti-commutation rules. Let me impose that CPR tilde, anti-commutator, now the Hilbert space, with CQS tilde dagger, is equal to delta, the analogous of the delta, so 2 pi q, 2 omega p, delta RS Kronecker, delta 3 of p minus q, and the same for the anti-commutator of dpr dqs Dacker. So instead of imposing that the commutator of CC dagger and mini dagger are proportional to the deltas, I'm going to impose that the anti-commutator is equal to the deltas, and also that all other anti-commutators vanish. So the anti-commutator of CPR CQS, or the anti-commutator between a C, P, R, and D, Q, S, and all other combinations are actually zero. So I basically replace all commutators, the usual commutation rules, with anti-commutators. And it's clear why you want to do that, because then when you will exchange this D and D dagger, you will get a D dagger D with a plus, which is what you want to get a positive definite operator. So if I do that, indeed here I can write that this is equal to plus D dagger D minus the anti-commutator of D and D dagger, right? Because this is minus D D dagger, or plus, probably. No, sorry, minus. So this is minus D D dagger, which is exactly this, plus So minus the dagger D, which which simplifies it. So the sum of these two is indeed equal to this. Now, the anticommutator of D the dagger is just a constant, something proportional to delta function into per Q2 omega. This is the analogous infinity that you get also for the scalar case. But what you'll be left with is that the non-constant part, which instead is positive definite. C dagger C and the dagger D are Hermitian and the positive definite operator. So now your Hamiltonian is well defined, and you can define your Hilbert space as usual, right? You define the vacuum as the state which is annihilated by all the C's and all the D's. And then you start constructing particle states by applying the D dagger, the creation operator, C dagger, a D dagger with the generic momenta P and spinor basis R. Just a curiosity before now we discuss the implication of what we just did. In this case, the Hamiltonian will have a constant term. You remember the infinity constant term that we subtracted by hand in the case with a minus sign. So each, in this case, the zero-point energy of each oscillator in the spin 1/2 case have a negative, it's like a negative 1/2 contribution. So it's exactly the opposite sign of spin zero fields. This is a generic feature, and it's in the past it was thought that this could help solving removing exactly the contribution to the zero-point energy by adding as many spin 1/2 fields as spin zero field, half integer or integer spin. But of course this, so there is a symmetry associated to this cancellation between this different spin party, which is called supersymmetry. Fortunately, supersymmetry is not an exact symmetry, so this cancellation is not exact, and it will be left anyway with the same problem. But, this was just a curiosity. All right, so it seems that this trick would allow us to have a very well-defined theory now for half integer spin, but we are paying a very big price because we broke one of the fundamental rules, right, that we started with when we constructed quantum field theory, which was the commutation rule, which was closely related to causality. So you might wonder whether this change in our commutation, in our quantization rule, might pose a danger for causality, and you'll be completely allowed to ask this question. But let me answer this question in 5 minutes after I say some extra few words about the implication of these commutation rules for the spectrum of the theory. So let me put aside for extra 5 minutes the big elephant in the room associated to the fact that we twisted our rules and see what these anti-commutation rules really mean for the structure of the trick. So I'm going to erase this part unless you have questions on the mathematics. Okay. this, I don't mean. So as I mentioned before, you can imagine constructing the Hilbert space, the Fock space of the theory, right? By introducing a vacuum, which is the state such that when you apply a field tilde PR or PR tilde, you get zero. And then you can start constructing states by just applying to the vacuum the creation operator, C, P, R, the vacuum, going to call it 1, the excitation with momentum P, and R, which is from 1 to 2, is basically the speed of the particle, R. So for each momentum P, there are two possible different particles that you can create, which is labeled by this index R. And we will see probably Monday, that indeed these two choice of R correspond indeed to the two possible polarization of spin 1/2 particle plus 1/2 or minus 1/2. For the moment, we just assume this is the case, or anyway, just take that for each particle P, there are two possible type of particles. And analogously, we can use d tilde dag PR to create different type of particles, like the particle type D from the vacuum. This I'm going to call it U bar. We'll see that these are the antiparticles indeed, with momentum P, and again, label R for the spin. So these are the one particle states, and you can consider two particle states by iterating the process, continuing applying C and D's to these states here. But now, let me notice what happens if you try to actually create a state with two particles which have exactly the same quantum numbers. What I'm saying is that let's try to now from here apply an extra C tilde P Geiger R to the one particle state with quantum numbers P and R. So this must be equal to C tilde P Geiger R C tilde P Geiger R vacuum. But now notice that anticommutator of C with another C is zero. So this means that this product must be zero. In other words, if you take the anticommutator of C Geiger and C Geiger, this is C Geiger, C Geiger plus C Geiger, C Geiger must be equal to zero, but this is the same object, which means that it must be zero. So from the anticommutation rules, it follows that the product of two creation operators identical with the same quantum numbers must vanish. This means that it cannot exist a state with two particles with exactly the same quantum numbers, which is the Pauli exclusion principle. Similarly, we might consider now the wave function of two particle states constructed P1 and P2 the state of two particles with a generic wave function constructed. Oh, now I'm using the same symbol for the field and the wave function. Let me call it F of P1, R1, P2, R2. So this is the wave function of two particle states. I also have to sum over R1 and R2. And here I put the two particle states with the momentum P1 and P2, R1 and R2 spins, which is equivalent to C tilde dagger P1, R1, C tilde dagger P2, R2, applying to the latch. So this is a generic two particle state with wave function F of P1, R1, P2, R2. Which describe momentum and spin of the first particle, momentum and spin of the second particle. Again, because of the anti-commutation rules, which tells that the anti-commutator of two C daggers must vanish, this basically implies that C dagger of P1 and P2 must be equal to minus C dagger P2, C dagger P1. Which means that this combination is equivalent to C dagger P1 R1 C dagger P2 R2 minus C dagger P2 R2 C dagger P1 R1. And this basically automatically selects the antisymmetric combination of the wave function P1 R1 P2 R2 minus F of P2 R2 P1 R1. Which means that the wave function of two particle states associated to spin or fields must be antisymmetric. And of course the same will be true for any particle states. Anti-commutation relation imply complete antisymmetry of the wave function of spin or field, which is indeed the Fermi-Dirac statistics. So it seems that we are on the right track because we basically recovered all the properties of fermions, which indeed in nature are seen to be always associated to half-integer spin particles. So somehow, from the necessity to have a well-defined Hamiltonian, it came out that the only allowed statistics for the particle was the Fermi-Dirac one. Indeed, this is part of the spin statistic theorem that indeed demonstrates that half-integer spin need to be quantized in this way in order for the theory to be unitary and bounded from below and over. Questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
So in case of a scalar field, we saw that if we take the commutator of the scalar field with its conjugate momentum, we get something like Dirac delta function. So in case of fermionic field, we will have to take the anticommutator, right? Anticommutator of the field and
yes.
Its conjugate momentum.
Yeah. Yes, this is now what we are going to see next.
And
yeah.
And this was something we imposed by hand.
So far, yes. So far, we just imposed this by hand to be sure that Hamiltonian was positive. Yes. Yes, and this will be the next issue we are going to see, how this choice, which seems perfectly fine at the level of Hamiltonian and particles, how is this compatible with causality, the commutation rules, the canonical commutation rules, and so on. So just before moving on that part, just wanted to be sure that this part about the statistics and the particles were clear. So basically the generic state in the Fock space will be a state with either zero particle or one particle state with each specific quantum numbers. So the occupation number for a generic state can be either 0 or 1. So we can have only one particle going to p and spin r, one particle going to q and spin s, and so on. Or also antiparticle. But you cannot have more than one particle on each slot of quantum numbers. So this is the most general state. So for this very reason, you can argue that indeed you will never be able to actually construct a classical fermion field. You remember in the scalar case, a classical field was just a collection of many particles or many excitation of the field. When the excitation of the field was large, this would correspond to excite an harmonic oscillator a lot. And the more you excite it away from the ground state, the more classical it looks. Same for the fields. The more you excite the field, the more quanta you have for each mode, the more away you are from actually realizing that this quanta are discretized, and the more the field will behave like a classical field. Indeed, a classical electromagnetic field, like a radio wave, is a collection of a zillion and zillion and zillion of photons with the same quantum numbers, which basically makes the amplitude of your radio wave macroscopic. You will never be able to do this for fermions because each Fourier mode cannot be excited more than the first excitation. So for this reason, fermionic fields are always in the quantum regime. There is no notion of a classical fermion field. And that's the reason why in nature, every time there is a spin half integer particle, we always treat it as a particle, never as a classical field. Why classical fields are always associated to bosonic degrees of freedom, like the photon or the graviton. We talk about the gravitational field. You talk about electromagnetic fields, but you rarely, well, you never talk about a classical electron field. Okay? So for this reason, basically, fermions, most of the time, they behave like particles, and you associate to matter, while interactions are typically mediated at the macroscopic level by integer spin particles. All right? And now, if you allow, I will finish by discussing how these commutation rules, anti-commutation rules, are compatible with causality. Okay, so basically what we do is to go backwards. So we imposed these anti-commutation rules for C and D's. And now we can try to compute the anti-commutator of the field of psi of x with this conjugate momentum, which was I psi dagger of y, at equal time slice, for example, t equal to 0, for x naught equal to 1 naught. Okay? So this is a matrix. I'm computing the anticommutator between one component of the psi field and another component of the psi dagger field. Maybe I will leave you as an exercise to actually do the full computation. All you have to do is just substitute the solution psi in terms of C and D dagger, and psi dagger in terms of C dagger and D. You're going to compute anticommutators. So in this product, you see that there will appear anticommutator of C and D and C dagger and D dagger, which we wrote what they are. So they will give you just delta functions. And thanks to those delta functions, you can remove one integral in delta. And at the end of the day, what you will be left with after you use all the identities is just I delta 3 of x minus y. I leave you as an exercise. I'll probably put it the full steps in the notes. So in case you get lost in the derivation, you can check what they are. Okay? So this is not very surprising, right? We substitute all commutation with anticommutation. So now when you compute the anticommutator of psi with this conjugate momentum, you actually get the analogous of the commutation rule, the I delta 3. Of course, this thing is disastrous for the commutation relation, because if it's true that these two objects anti-commute, they cannot at the same time commute. So if we now compute the commutator of psi x and I psi dagger, or let me compute actually the commutator even easier, between psi x and psi y, at equal time. So this is what? Well, you see, don't even need to compute. Psi of x has inside C and D dagger. Also this psi has C and D dagger. Each C and D dagger, C and D dagger, they all anti-commute within themselves. So basically this is what? Psi of x, psi of y, minus psi of y, psi of x. But this object here, because it's anti-commute, is equal to plus psi of x, psi of y. So this commutator is just twice psi of x, psi of y, which is clearly non-zero. So already we find that the commutator of two operators a space like distances is not zero. Which seems to violate causality. So how we save the day? So we can save the day by one small word I said when I said that we wanted to impose commutation relation. You remember when we at the very first, no, not the very first, but the first time we discussed microcausality, when we derived that the commutation must vanish outside the light cone, we were using the fact that we wanted this to be true in such a way that signals, right, cannot influence observations at space-like separated distances. So we didn't want that a measurement or any deformation of the theory in one space-time point could influence any other measurement in another space-time point which were space-like separated. So the commutator of observable operators must vanish outside the light cone. So the keywords here is observable operators. So the only way this can be compatible with causality is that this operator here, psi of x, is actually not an observable operator. If there is no way to actually measure this fermion field, then I'm fine. All I need to require is that observable operator built out of psi commute outside the light curve. And this is indeed what is going to happen. To see indeed that psi of x cannot be a good observable operator, let me use symmetry. So let me assume that psi can be observed on some state. So I'm going to define my state A, and I'm going to associate a measurement on my state A of this operator, psi of x. Okay? Now, if this is observable, I can imagine the following. I make my observation, and then I just turn myself by 2 pi, and I make the same observation. I should get the same answer, right? I didn't change anything. So, but a rotation of 2 pi means that I'm going to consider a new state, which is just a part of the Poincaré transformation, right? The one associated to rotation by 2 pi. I don't know how to call it. R 2 pi, okay? You remember, it's e to the I epsilon mu nu j mu nu, where epsilon mu nu, you just choose 2 pi times j I j around some axis. So now, this object here, after rotation of 2 pi, must be also equal to the one that is rotated by 2 pi. So this must be equal to a prime psi of x, a prime, which is equal to a u dagger 2 pi psi of x u 2 pi a. Now I can use the way fields transform under rotations, and a spinor field under rotation transform with s 2 pi psi of lambda 2 pi r 2 minus 1 x. But a 2 pi rotation of the coordinate leave all the coordinates invariant, right? So psi goes into itself. And here I'm multiplying by the representation of rotation in spinor space of a rotation of 2 pi. But you remember last time we argued that for a spinor, a rotation of 2 pi sends a spinor in minus itself. So this s is just minus 1. So this object is also equal to a psi of x, a with a minus in front. But if this matrix element must be equal to minus itself, it means that the only allowed value is zero. Which means that you can never observe a field that is associated to a half integer spin representation of the Lorentz group. The last means this step.
The last statement, the very last statement you made just now.
So the last statement I made just now was that you will never be able to measure the a field in the spinorial representation of the Lorentz group, in the half integer representation of the Lorentz group, because every operator, local operators, that transform as an half integer representation of the Lorentz group, if you compute their matrix element on a physical state, they will go into minus themselves, and therefore those matrix elements must be identically zero. So the only operators, so of course I could have repeat the same discussion for any half integer spin operator, local operator, and the same would have been true. So the only operator that can actually be associated to a non-trivial observation, whose expectation value on physical states is non-zero, are operators that transform under integer spin representation of the Lorentz group. So for fermions, this means, for this Dirac spinor fields, this means that the only operators that I can construct, which are out of them, which are associated to observable properties, are at least bilinear of psi. For example, I can construct the operator O of x, which is psi bar psi, which is a local operator, and transform as a scalar. This, of course, can give me a non-zero expectation value for a non-zero matrix element. In fact, if you think about all observable we constructed so far of the fermion field are associated to bilinears. For example, if you look at the Hamiltonian, which measures the energy of a particle, it's a bilinear of psi bar psi. If you look at the momentum operator, the energy momentum, the spin, all these operators are all bilinears of the fermions. So as such, they are bosonic operator, and as such, they can be and are associated to observable features. So whenever we have a fermion, like an electron, we don't measure actually the electron field, which is unobservable. What we measure is its energy, its three momentum, its angular momentum, its spin, and in doing so, what we are actually measuring are bilinears of fermions, bosonic operators. And now you can check that indeed, thanks to these anti-commutation rules, the commutation rules of bilinears are actually satisfy the microcausality condition. You can actually check that, for example, if you take psi bar psi, for example, at point x, psi bar psi at the point y, a commute a commutator, each psi anti-commute with each of them, but since there are two of them, two anti-commutation make a commutation. So if you actually compute explicitly psi bar psi the commutator, you find something that is proportional to a delta, which means that when they are at space like separator region, give you zero. And this happens only with anti-commutation. So you can, in order for bosonic operator to commute outside the Lyapunov, the only two choices you have are commutation or anti-commutation. With commutation, you get problems with Hamiltonian, with the fact that the theory is unbounded from below. So the only option which allow observable to be satisfying microcausality is anti-commutation. And this is basically part of the spin statistic theory. So to summarize, you see that we found a way to quantize the fermionic field. It's not in conflict with microcausality because, after all, the fermionic field itself is not observable. All bosonic observable operators do satisfy the right commutation rules. And basically the implication we obtain from the commutation, anti-commutation rules is exactly spin statistics, which basically it's derived itself directly from having a healthy theory compatible with the Lorentz invariant and microcausality.
And basically this difference between half integer and integer half fields can be extended to any spin. So for any spin, basically you can prove that if you have half integer representation or integer representation, the statistics is associated, it's either bosonic or fermionic. At the end of the day, it really has to do with the way they transform under Lorentz. Right? Questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
So, as you have seen, that when we took the Hamiltonian for spin half particle, we got the negative sign, and that actually forced us to impose the anti-commutation relation. So I was just asking that, is there any straightforward way to see that, I mean, how this spin half integer is related to this negative sign?
The negative sign you get in front of DD bar is actually not an exclusive feature of half integer spin particles. You will see that we get something similar also for spin 1 particle, higher spin. The minus sign comes from the fact that if the field transforms non-trivially under Lorentz, since Lorentz is non-compact, then you don't have a positive definite Hamiltonian. So the way to save the Hamiltonian for half integer spin, it's always by changing the statistics, the commutation rules. For vector, instead, we will see that we have to do a different thing.
So if we constructed a theory for SO4 group, then we had a positive sign?
Yes.
So in that case, we didn't need anti-commutation relation?
Right, but the SO4 doesn't have a time evolution.
Yes, I mean, just that.
Yes. So even the Hamiltonian is... All right, any other?
I have a
yes.
question relating with the... When we, for example, solve the Dirac equation with plane waves, we have that one part is related to positive energy solutions and the other with negative energy. Does that have the same meaning with the D dagger and the creation of the antiparticle here?
The two things are related, but you see, we also got we had a similar thing already for the scalar field. If you remember, also for the scalar field, we had positive frequency and negative frequency. And the reason why we have always positive frequency and negative frequency, right, is that all these fields satisfy Klein-Gordon equation, right? And which basically tells you that omega squared is equal to p squared plus m squared. And so omega always have two solutions, one with positive and one with negative sign. So the positive frequency and negative frequency sign. So if you associate this omega with the energy, with the Hamiltonian, then you get that states with positive energy and negative energy. And this was the mistake, quote unquote, of the initial attempt to quantize the Dirac equation, or also Klein-Gordon equation for spin zero field, to interpret this negative sign as a negative, so basically to interpret the field as a wave function. This will be the Hamiltonian, and then you'll get both signs for the Hamiltonian, which are bad, because if you have a negative energy, you have unbounded from below Hamiltonian in energy. In field theory, this negative sign actually is associated to a negative frequency. And it's associated to the fact, as you see in the solution, that, let me go back to the scalar case, so I have less indices. And associated to the fact that here, basically, every time we have a positive energy, or negative energy if you want here, we remove a particle, and positive energy create a particle. So the sign associated to omega here is associated to the fact that you are removing a particle or adding a particle. So the negative is just you are removing a particle. But the Hamiltonian is always bounded from below because the spectrum is constructed in such a way that there is a ground state under which you cannot go, like the harmonic oscillators in quantum mechanics. So if you want, when you go from non-relativistic quantum mechanics to field theory, the advantage that you have is that basically these frequencies here are just the Fourier modes of the field. They are not directly the energy of the system. The energy system is given by the Hamiltonian, which is bounded from below. Instead, if you associate instead of the field, you take that as a wave function, this will be the Hamiltonian, this omega, and then you will have problems with boundedness of the energy. Other questions? Okay, so you have all the weekend to think more about what we did today. I'm a little bit behind in writing the notes, so anyway, this evening I will send you what I already wrote so far. It should be all the scalar field except the salience.